world of Jeppes has reached its limit. It was now mid-August, which meant he'd be separated from Marcia for more than 2 months. 2 months! And all he had to show was three dopey Atlantas and two very expensive long-distance phone calls. True, when school had ended, and he returned to Wisconsin, and he to Locust, Pennsylvania, she had sworn to maintain a certain fidelity. She could date occasionally, but merely as amusement. She would remain faithful. But lately, Waldo had begun to worry. He had trouble sleeping at night. When he did, he had horrible dreams. He lay awake at night, tossing and turning. Marcia, his sworn vows overcome by liquor, and his smooth soothing of some Neanderthal, finally submitted to the final caresses of sexual oblivion. It was more than the human mind could bear. Visions of Martha's faithlessness haunted him. Daytime fantasies of sexual abandon permeated his thoughts, and the thing was, they wouldn't understand how she really was. He, Waldo, alone understood this. He had intuitively grasped every nook and cranny of his psyche. He had made her smile. She needed him, and he wasn't there. Oh. The idea came to him on the Thursday before the Mama's Parade was scheduled to be there. He just finished mowing and edging Edelson's lawn for $1.50. And I checked the mailbox to have seen if there was at least a word from Marcia. There was nothing but a circular from the Amalgamated Aluminium Company of America inquiring into his oil needs. At least they cared enough to write. It was a New York company. You could go anywhere in the mails. Then it stuck him. He didn't have enough money to go to Wisconsin in the accepted fashion. True, but why not mail himself? It was absurdly simple. He would ship himself, parcel, post, special delivery. The next day, Waldo went to the supermarket to purchase the necessary equipment. He bought masking tape, a staple gun, and a medium-sized card box, just right for a person of his build. He judged that with a minimum of jostling, he could ride quite comfortably. A few air holes, some water, perhaps some midnight snacks, and it would probably be as good as going tourist. By Friday afternoon, Waldo was set. He was thoroughly packed, and the post office had agreed to pick him up at 3 o'clock. He marked the package fragile, and as he sat curled up inside, resting on the foam rubber cushioning he thoughtfully included, he tried to picture the look of awe and happiness on Marcia's face as she opened the door, saw the package, tipped the deliverer, and then opened it to see her, Waldo, finally there in person. She would kiss him, and then maybe they could see a movie. If he'd only thought of this before, suddenly rough hands gripped his. Back into he felt himself come up. He landed with a thud, and in a truck. And he was off. Marcia Bronson had just finished setting her hair. It had been a very rough weekend. She had tried to remember not to drink like that. Bill had been nice about it though. After it was over, he said he still respected her. And after all, it was certainly the way of nature. And even though he didn't love her, he didn't feel any affection for her. And after all, they were grown adults. Oh, what Bill could teach Waldo, but that seemed many, many years ago. Sheila Klein, her very, very best friend, walked in through the porch screen door and into the kitchen. Oh God, it's absolutely morning outside. Ah, I know what you mean, I feel all in you. Marcia tightened the belt on her cotton robe with her silk outer edge. Sheila ran her finger over some salt grains on the kitchen table, licked her finger and made a face. I'm supposed to be taking these salt pills, but she wiggled her nose. They make me feel like throwing up. Marsh decided to pass herself into the chin, an exercise she's seen on television. God, don't even talk about that. She got up from the table and went to the sink, where she picked up a bottle of pink and blue vitamins. What one? Supposed to be better than steak. And then attempted to touch her knees. I don't think I'll ever touch a daiquiri again. She gave up and sat down. The tie knew at a small table that supported the telephone. Maybe Billboard said to Sheila's class. Sheila nibbled on her cuticle. After last night, I thought maybe you'd be doing it. I know what you mean. My God, he was like an octopus, hands all over the place. She gestured, raising her arms upwards in defense. The thing is, after a while, you get tired of fighting with him, you know? And after all, I didn't really do anything Friday and Saturday, so I kind of owed it to him. You know what I mean? She started to scratch. Cheryl comes giggling with her hand over her mouth. I tell you, I've come the same way. And even after a while, yeah, she bent forward in a whisper. I wanted to. Now she was laughing very loudly. It was at this point that Mr. Jameson of the Clarence Darrow Post Office rang the doorbell of the large studio-coloured frame house. When Marsha Bronson opened the door, he helped her carry the package in. He had his yellow and his green slips of paper signed and left with a 15-cent tip that Marsha had gotten out of her mother's small beige pocketbook in his head. What do you think it is? Sheila asked. Marsha stood with her arms folded behind her back. She stared at the brown cardboard carton and sat in the middle of the living room. I don't know. Inside the package, all the women excitement as she listened to the muffled voices. Sheila ran her fingernail over the masking tape and ran down the centre of the carton. Why don't you look at the return address and see which one? Waldo felt his heart beating. He could feel the vibrating footsteps. It would be soon. Marsha walked around the carton, the red pink scratch label. Ah, God, it's from Waldo. That smack, said Sheila. Waldo trembled with expectation. Well, you might as well open it, said Sheila. Waldo then tried to lift the stable flap. Ah, shit, said Marsha, groaning. He must have nailed it shut. They tugged on the flap again. My God, you need a power drill to get this thing open. They pulled again, you'd go get a grip. They both stood up, breathing heavily. Why don't you get a scissor, said Sheila. Marsha ran into the kitchen, but all she could find was a little sewing scissor. Then she remembered that her father kept an erection of tools in the basement. She went upstairs, and when she came back up, she had a large sheet metal cutter in her hand. This is the best I could find. She was barely out of breath. Here, you do it. I'm gonna die. She sank into a large fucking pouch and exhaled noisily. Sheila tried to make a slip between the mask and tape and the end of the cardboard flap, but the blade was too big and there wasn't enough room. Goddamn thing, she said, feeling very exasperated. Then smiling, I got an idea. What, said Marsha. Just walk, said Sheila, touching her finger to her head. Inside the package, Waldo was so transfixed with excitement that he could barely breathe. His skin felt prickly from the heat, and he could feel his heat beating in his throat. It would be soon. Sheila stood up, walked around to the other side of the package. Then she sank down to her knees, grasped the cutter by both handles, took a deep breath, and plunged the long blade through the middle of the package. Through the masking tape, through the cardboard, through the cushioning, and crunch right to the center of Waldo Jeffers' head. It spread slightly across little rhythmic arcs of red to pulsate gently in the morning sun.